pray before we talk about worship. Father, we pray, God, help us connect with you even now. Help us to be conscious of your presence and grateful for your love for us. Pray that for my own heart and the heart of every person here, or anybody might watch a video or listen to a recording, Father, we pray that something from tonight will give us a better glimpse of who you are and why you're worthy of worship. And particularly tonight, God, as we talk about how we, when we worship together, it strengthens us and helps us to be more what you've called us to be people of the kingdom, standing in the kingdom, and members of this local church congregation. That God, you'll help us to become stronger in our faith, more devoted to one another in love, and to better represent Jesus Christ to the community around us. Father, open our hearts, open our minds, help us to put aside any preconceived ideas and to look at your word and the example that we see there for what we need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Class two of standing before the throne and before the Lamb. And tonight, we're not talking, I want to remind us, as I did last week, that we're not talking so much about personal worship. Of course, it is all personal. But we're not talking so much about our personal times of devotion. We're talking in these three classes about our corporate body worship together on a Sunday, on a Friday, in our family groups, in our families, whenever a few Christians get together with the intention of worshiping God together. So that's what we're talking about here. Another reminder that this passage, I think, is so important to where what we consider to be corporate worship. In Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, after this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. They fell down on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, saying, "Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen." We join this kind of heavenly assembly when we worship together. This is ultimately, in a sense, where we're going, but it's what we join in together with even now when we gather to worship. It's not just a little dinky group in some hall. It's together with the hosts of heaven that we worship. Revelation 7. Now, let's talk about LIGO for a minute, because I want to remind us of who we're worshipping. Who knows what LIGO is, apart from the fact that I put it on the screen? Thank you very much. Who's heard of LIGO? Yeah, one, two, okay, a couple of people here. Your laser interferometer gravitational wave observatory. Yes, which we all know about. Okay. So these, I think, do you want to explain what it is?
Oh, really? Come on, Barry.
You know what it is? You can explain it if you like.
It's basically, it's a facility over in the States where they've got two very straight, long particle accelerators where they can actually, they're sensitive to gravitational waves. So gravitational waves are a key thing which Einstein predicted years and years ago, and scientists are either trying to prove his theories right or wrong. And what's happened just recently in the news is we've detected this cataclysmic collision somewhere across the universe by these two tunnels, and just by the very sensitive particle beams that have picked up the gravitational waves. So gravity itself, so the whole universe has been reverberating pretty much with this massive explosion. So,
she knows her stuff. I'm impressed. I listened to a whole 25-minute podcast on it, and I don't understand it as well as you. I'm very impressed. So Einstein predicted it. They discovered these gravitational waves, evidence of them a few years ago, but just recently there's this extra thing that's happened where they've put together this particular experiment together with optical astronomy as well to detect this particularly large explosion, which is very interesting. So what they discovered is, so you have a star, and when it collapses, it becomes a supernova and then a neutron star. And they detected a collision of two neutron stars, which is just one of the most colossal things. It's released more energy than anything other than black holes, basically. So to give you an idea of the scale of these things, and the reason I'm bringing this up is, again, to blow our minds about how incredible the universe is and the fact that our God made it. So the resultant explosion has left a mass about 1.5 times the size of our sun. So our sun is pretty big. But that mass, now our sun is colossal. As you saw a picture maybe last week of the comparison of the sun compared to the Earth. The Earth is a dot compared to the sun. So the sun, 1.5 times the sun, the mass of that has been shrunk down to something that's only 15 kilometers in radius, which is basically the size of London. So from the sun down to the size of London, that's but the mass 1.5 times the sun, the density, and this is the thing I want to describe to you, by using this visual aid that I picked up this afternoon in a pub. So this is a sugar cube, right? So to give you an idea of the incredible numbers and size of things that we're talking about, these two neutron stars who've collapsed into, well, become the super neutron star, the density in this neutron star is such that it's equivalent to shrinking the whole of the population of the world into this sized sugar cube. So can you imagine trying to compress the density of all human beings on this planet currently into this, and that's the density that's out there detected by LIGO and other telescopes and detecting equipment. And this is one of, how many billions of stars are there? We talked about this last week. Was it 300 or 500 billion?
Well, in our galaxy alone, there's about, I think, 200 to 300 billion.
Okay, just in our galaxy.
There's about that many galaxies in the universe, wow. So you've got to square it.
You've got to square
it. It's a ridiculous number.
How's your brain doing this Friday evening? With all those numbers. I mean, this exists. The sugar cube exists. These numbers and these forces exist in the universe many, many, many billions of times over in this incredible place that God made. I like to reflect on this scripture here. That's Psalm 147. He determines the number of the stars and calls them each by name. Great is our Lord. Understatement. And mighty in power. His understanding has no limits. Our understanding has limits. And we're understanding more and more about the universe, and that's great, but it's still limited. To our God, this is not complicated.
Wow.
I find that mind-boggling. Would anybody like my sugar cube? Oh, I think you've earned the sugar cube.
That's a taste of people.
I want us to start there because I want to remind us of who we're worshipping before we get into some of the more practical things that we're going to talk about today, so that we don't get derailed onto the physical, practical things we do and forget why we're doing what we're doing in our corporate times of worship. Our amazing God. So class two, standing in the need of prayer, which I have subtitled or added to as from that song, rather than it's me, O Lord, it's us, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's not just me, it's not just you, it's us as a group who are standing in the need of prayer and praying to this great God. That's what we're talking about today. Let's talk about prayer for a little bit. So, Prayer is mentioned a great deal in the New Testament. I've given you there on the slide, and don't need to write this all down, but just for the moment here. So these are the numbers of times prayer is mentioned in each of the books of the New Testament. There's all your books, and there's the number of times. And these are the number of hits per thousand words. So per every thousand words in Matthew, that's three quarters of the mention of the word prayer, if you like. So it gives you the idea of how much the theme of prayer is significant in each book in the New Testament. So I want to point out to you two that stand out there, which is Luke with 27 and Acts with 33, and much higher ratios than most of the other books except for small epistles, but that the ratio doesn't work so well with the stats there. 173 mentions of prayer or praying in 158 verses in the New Testament. Very significant. Luke and Acts to point it out there. Of course, Luke wrote both the Gospel of Luke and Acts, and it seems that he had a particular emphasis on prayer, as we see there. 27 mentions in Luke, 33 in Acts, a number of significant references. And I think that's because partly he wanted to show us the devotion of Jesus to the topic of prayer, but also the devotion of the church and the early Christians to the topic of prayer. Those are your references. I think they're on the handout. However, what I wanted to point out is this. The ones highlighted in red are group prayer in the book of Acts. You see how many there are? There's not that many of individual prayer in the book of Acts. It's almost all, or mostly, group prayer. The green highlights are possible group prayer. In other words, it doesn't say it's a group praying, but the implication seems to be that it's more than one Christian that were present at the time. The purple, the one reference to the purple, is prayer in public by an individual, even though he's not with a group of people praying, and that's Stephen, who prays as he is executed. But he's still praying in public, so it's a public thing. So we see there the emphasis on group prayer in the book of Acts. Now, I'm not going to go through all those references right now, but we are going to do a little bit of work here. So what I'd like you to do is have a look at one or two references on your handout. Pick out one or two, and with the person sitting next to you, look at one or two. You can pick any on the list. And I'd like you to ask yourself or each other this question. What do these corporate worship times achieve for the church? I'm focusing on prayer here, not because prayer is the only thing we can be doing, but just as an example of what the early church was doing in the book of Acts. They were often praying together. So pick one where you find a group of Christians, whether it's a smaller group like Acts 13 or a larger group like Acts 4, praying together. And think about this question. I'm giving you only 2 minutes, and there is a countdown timer, shall begin shortly, on what did this corporate worship time achieve for the church. Have a look at that and discuss that together for 2 minutes, and then we'll come back and see what we've discovered. On your marks, get set, and go. Time is up. Excellent. Okay, what stands out? Tell me which scripture you picked and what was happening, and then what stands out was the benefit of the church.
We use the Greek scripture, can I read it?
Yeah.
It's Acts 20, verse 36. It says, when Paul had finished speaking, he knelt down with all of them and prayed. They all wept as they embraced him and kissed him. What grieved them was his statement that they would never see his face again. And they accompanied him to the ships. What Richard said was great, how this brought the focus back to God. Such a sort of a massive moment, bringing it back to God, bringing it back to sort of the spiritual significance of this.
God was in the picture with this whole thing. It wasn't just they were parting and, oh, it's terrible, and, oh, you know, it's... But actually, God's part of that situation. That's great. Thank you. Okay, another one, a different one. Someone got a different one. Yes, Obi, which one?
We read Acts 13, where the church in Antioch, it says that they were worshipping and fasting, and then the Holy Spirit said, set apart from me, Barnabas and Saul, for the work which I have called them. And what we said, that is the spirit of worshipping as a church, that God can make it very clear that he has a vision that is beyond what we might be thinking about at that time.
That's a great point, isn't it? God's vision was greater than what they understood it to be. Personally, the people there, but the local church in Antioch, and perhaps even beyond that. Excellent. So we get a bigger picture of God's... Johnsy and Karen.
So we read Acts 16, verse 25, which is when Paul is praying with Silas in the prison. He says, at about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and at once all the doors were open. And then later on, it goes on to say that... the jailer called for lights, but they were then asked, Paul and Silas were asked, says, what must we do to be saved? They replied, believe in the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved, you and your household. Then they spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all the others. It says later in verse 33 that all his household were baptized. It's pretty amazing just from praying that suddenly all these things then took place, you know, the earthquake. But I think most importantly that it led to someone having a relationship with God this time of prayer.
And not in a way they would have imagined.
No.
Right? So we sometimes wonder, how can we help people become Christians?
Yeah.
Right? I mean, is it all about what we say,
right,
what we do, or is it about prayer and God doing the unexpected?
Yeah.
I'm not saying it's one or the other, but it's just, do we think enough about this side of it? That some just a couple of Christians praying together in circumstances that were less than ideal, you could argue. I mean, I don't know if I'd be thinking about praying and singing hymns in jail at that point. Just two of them, but it was enough. Great point. Okay, Karen. Yeah.
As you're sort of following on from that, we chose at people to devote themselves to.
They devoted themselves to oops?
Yeah.
Right. New translation. So let me check that.
Yeah, it's all right. Okay, nearly there. Hold on.
Come on,
Karen. Bear with.
Go on, you can do it, Karen.
They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship of the bread and to prayer. And then basically, that's the important too, but it then leads on to all the believers being close, having everything in common. And then it leads on to that about 47, and the Lord added to their number daily those that were being saved. And I think it's a similar sort of thing to Johnny and what you were saying as well, is prayer brings you closer together and you want to be together, and then people can see that and they can see what you've got, and then they want to want a bit there.
They want some of what they can see. What a great point. Super. A couple more, Albert.
We chose God and I, 5:33. They said to him, John's disciples, often fast and pray, and certain disciples of the Pharisees, but yours go on eating and drinking. So the verse is quite confusing. But it's referring to the fact that effectively the... and it's not clear whether or not it's John's disciples or disciples of Pharisees. But anyhow, it's the old God do it a certain way, and Jesus' team do it a different way. And Jesus goes on to say that you don't put new wine in an old wineskin. And basically he's saying that you know, he's bringing the new, and there will be new ways. And so... when you're going to do new things, it really is better to do it with like-minded people.
Yes,
because
true.
Otherwise you're just doing it by yourself and you'll just fall back into the old ways.
What old ways, comfortable ways, yes. Mm. And we see from the book of Acts that the Christian life is rarely comfortable. So people needed one another. Excellent. One more or we'll move on? We got one more? Yes, Wally.
Okay, look. 11, 1 and 2.
Uh-huh.
It says, and one day Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of the disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. He said to them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. One of the things I think the corporate worship here is that the disciples were vulnerable to ask Jesus to teach them to pray. Mm-hmm. And it's something that just shows that we can learn to pray. It's not beyond, my prayer may not just come naturally, mm-hmm. we can learn. Mm-hmm. So it just talks about, you know, being vulnerable to ask for help when you need.
Okay, thank you very much. Sue, you know, one of the things that I would like to say at this point is, it could be that when we do a class like this, we all think, we get convicted, we think, we should pray more. And maybe we should. But maybe it's not about praying more. Maybe it's about understanding what's actually happening when we pray. And having a different attitude when we pray with our brothers and sisters, whether it's at home or whether it's here on a Friday or a Sunday or in our location services. So I just want to say that so that we don't get to thinking, okay, the problem with our church is, or the problem with our group is, we don't pray enough. It might be. And that's what you've got to wrestle with, that as another issue, as one issue. But a secondary issue is, are we thinking about the way that God works in the same way the early church clearly thought about the way God worked and utilized their times together of worshiping together to the best so that God was able to use them and do the astonishing things Amen. That God did through his Spirit. So I think that's a subtle thing to think about. Not just the quantity of prayer, but the attitude we take into our times of prayer when we're praying together. So let's go on and talk about a couple of other things. And I want to focus on Acts 4 for a moment. Let's go back there. I didn't think anybody picked this one, so that's good. I'm not going to read the whole passage, but just to remind us. Now, when things happened to the early Christians, their instinct was to pray. And their instinct, I might say, actually, is to gather together. And in gathering, then, amongst other things, to pray. In Acts 1, they are praying together. They are together in the upper room. And here in Acts 4, we see a time of persecution and opposition to the church. And their instinct is to gather. And in verse 24, they get together, they raise their voices. And I like the way it says that. They don't just get together, they raise their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, you made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You see how they begin with him. They don't begin with the problem. When you read the Psalms, do you notice? Sometimes David starts with his problems. God, where are you? You've abandoned me. I mean, sometimes he's like that. And other times he's like, God, you're amazing. You're awesome. You're powerful. You're mighty. You are my stronghold. I have confidence in you. You're going to sort this out for me. But I'm in a lot of trouble right now and I'm really feeling a bit, you know, stuck. So I don't think it's wrong to start one way or the other, but I really like this, that it must have been so pressing upon them that they were vulnerable, that they were weak. And yet what they start with is God. Wow. And I think that's why in our times when we get together, it's important to start with God. But one of the things I emphasize in our times on Sundays, for example, in our worship, is that I think it's usually healthy for most of our opening songs to be about God, not about us. And it's not wrong to sing a song about us or about our relationship with God, but I think it helps if we can first of all sing songs about how great is our God before we sing songs about our response. Yes. So, Here Am I, Send Me is a great song, but I don't think that's the first song. I'm not ready to be sent. I'm still got my head full of what's happening the rest of my day. I don't. Where am I being sent? Who's sending me? For what purpose? I don't even know where I am. I need to, oh, how great is my God. Oh, that's right. Okay. You know, how great thou art. Right. Okay. Thine be the glory. Right. So, to God be the glory. Okay. So that's who you are. And therefore that's who, okay, now I know who I am. And then towards the end of the service, we can sing, okay, Lord, send me. I'm ready to be with me, Lord. Be with me, Lord, as I leave this place. Does that make sense? And I want to encourage us as we design song services, those of us who have that privilege and think about it, to really think about that beginning. It's usually best to start with thinking about who he is before thinking about us and everything else that's going on. And I think that may be true for our own prayer times and our own family devotionals. Don't have those family devotionals where you've really used the family devotional to get your children to do something they don't want to do by telling them God is watching. Let's help our children understand who God is by singing songs about God and praying about God and and our own understanding of God and our connection with God before we go on to other things. Anyway, I slightly digress, but I love what they do here. They focus on God, and then towards the end, after they've prayed all the prayers, after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. I love that. Now, weren't they already filled with the Holy Spirit? I mean, no Christian isn't filled with the Holy Spirit. It's just expressing something about, I think, their connection with the reality that they are filled. Perhaps it's a bit like they didn't realize how filled they were. Something like that. And I think, isn't that true for us? I mean, sometimes I come to church conscious that I'm a Christian and I love God, but I don't feel it. It's not changing my day and who I am very much. And after I've had a time with my friends here, I had to pray and hear the word preached and sing, I go away a literally different person. I mean, I don't think I'd half recognize myself. If I met myself walking in as I was walking out, you know, from earlier, I don't think I would. I don't feel the same person. I'm not saying it's all about feelings, but I think there's something here about when we connect with God collectively, there's something powerful in that really genuinely changes us. Because it did then. It changed them when they spoke the word of God boldly. What a wonderful thing. Okay, now just to wrap up, some practical thoughts for us, just to finish off. How are we doing? Yep, we got 3 minutes. All right, so what helps us to be a full participant in the togetherness of powerful times of worship that result in our strengthening? I'd like us to be thinking about this over the weekend. Think about this in the next time you come to a time of corporate worship. What helps us, in other words, helps you or me, to be a full participant in the togetherness of these powerful times of worship that result in our strengthening personally, but also collectively as a group, as a body, wherever we are? What helps us with that? Apart from, first of all, connecting with God, but then we connect with one another. You know, we all want to be filled with joy. We all want to be connected. But sometimes we have to make ourselves available to connect with one another. And sometimes we have to invite others into that connection. There should never be someone who's left alone on the edge of our corporate times of worship. I'd like to encourage us to really think about this. That when we're worshiping together, that we're not in our own little world for half an hour. Like, it's just me and God. If it was just you and God, why did you come together with everybody else? And of course there's a personal connection. I understand that. There are moments in a service when it really is quite personal. Moments. But we're together for a reason. So let's be aware of who's around us. Who's sitting next to you? How are they doing? You're on this end of the row, and 15 seats over here, there's somebody over there, but there's no one in between. Why not scoot over there? You think, well, that might look a bit weird. Honestly, if you're worried about looking weird and you're a Christian, I mean, that ship has long sailed, right? You can't get through the Christian life without looking a bit weird to somebody. That's just the way it is. You might as well. There you go. Look, there's a perfect practical illustration. Right there. Thank you for that. And hear me well. I'm not saying it's a sin to sit on your own. I'm not saying that. And I must admit, you know, I quite like my space. And I do quite like having a spare seat next to me. I mean, I just do. But I've got to recognize I can't live my life that way. And there are times when we get together when it's good to sit next to someone and share in the singing and the praying and the listening of the word together. There's something about that that's right. Draw other people in. Smile at one another at church. You know, it's okay to smile and look at each other during our worship. I'd encourage us to hug one another, and not just at the beginning of church or at the end. I'd encourage us not to have a 5-minute conversation in the middle of communion. That's not the kind of connection I'm talking about. There will be time after the service is finished, right? And I think it's okay if somewhere we've already started singing, and I just want to say this as a kind of someone who leads worship from the front here, okay? I don't have a problem. If someone comes in And they get all over and give Joan a big hug while we're singing our first song. And that's fine. I don't think that's a problem. But if that person has a 5-minute conversation with Joan while we're singing two songs that are meant to connect us with God, I do think that's problematic.
Yeah.
Because for lots of reasons, which I haven't got time to go into here, but I think you'll agree with that. I think let's be respectful of the body as well as being friendly and connecting with God and one another as we worship together. Let's sit together, let's draw one another, get together. We're in this together. So the questions for us to think about over the weekend, apart from the one I put up earlier, what could your family or your family group or your location service do to experience more transformative times of worship, like we see in the book of Acts as an example? And as well as that, what suggestions do you have for us to be better at this as a congregation whenever we gather in whatever context that may be? Hope that's helpful. Next week we'll talk about stand up for Jesus.
Amen.